question.
Right, let's ask the question again. Muhammad had sex with a nine-year-old child. Should I follow that example?
You're a son of a bitch.
I applaud him for being better. Go the Shia. For being better than those Sunnis who want to uphold a paedophile as a prophet.
Look, halal and haram has already been established. And this is why in our school of thought, we have a principle. Everything is halal till proven haram.
Your revelation is neither perfected nor is it completed, which means your Quran is lying to you when it says that it is.
Can you name me any other six-year-old in history that has an understanding of what marriage is?
Okay, mate, listen, you're talking
That's a no.
You're talking about this times
that's
now.
That's a no.
We're talking 1400 years ago.
There's no six-year-old.
What about your great-granddad, Henry VIII, when he married a six-year-old?
There's no six-year-old.
What about your granddad, Jimmy Savile?
He's not a prophet, is he?
What about Jimmy Savile?
Not a prophet.
But listen, all right.
Not
did
a
the
prophet.
Parents agree to it?
Henry VIII.
Did Aisha's parents agree to it?
Oh, so that makes it okay.
No, hold on. Hold on.
So if I agree, child can have sex with a 50-year-old man, that's okay.
You're talking about this time.
So that's
okay. We're talking
okay.
1400 years ago.
Oh, that makes
you
it
told,
okay.
If you
so
told
prophet,
somebody 1400 years ago
God,
about cars,
a prophet,
if you told somebody 1400 years ago
is Muhammad an example
about cars,
today?
They would not believe
you. Is Muhammad
you.
An example
days,
today?
As I told you,
is
yes,
Muhammad
he is.
An, oh, there we go.
Yes.
So it,
and,
an example.
And for the next 100 years.
Brilliant.
And the
so,
one after.
So our best example
yes.
married a six-year-old and had sex with her when she was nine, and that's not paedophilia today.
Okay, what's that got to do with
is
you?
Is it paedophilia
did
today?
Did her parents allow it? Yes or no?
Would you have, a,
did her parents
would you have
allow
sex
it?
With a nine-year-old?
Hold on. Did her parents allow
would
it or not?
Would you have sex with
did
a nine-year-old?
Did her parents allow it or not?
Does that make it okay?
Yes. Her parents allowed it.
Yes, her parents allowed
what's it got to do with you?
Which proves the point.
What's it got to do with
what
you?
What six-year-old
what's it got to do
can
with you,
turn
though?
Around to their
listen,
parents
if,
and go,
nobody,
I'm sorry, I don't know what marriage is.
Then,
I don't want to marry
said
this old man.
Then, if nobody said anything then, who are you to say something now?
I'm going to tell you who I am.
Oh, no, I
don't
want to know who you
man
are.
Than your prophet.
I don't want to know who you are. But who are you to say
in
what
the
he
21st
is?
Century
did he have
is
enemies?
Better
did,
than a 7th century Bedouin
or not?
Who married
did
a 6-year-old girl and had sex
years
with
ago?
Her
did
when
any
she was
of
9
his enemies,
years old.
Did any of
on
his enemies,
this matter,
did
on
any
this question,
of his enemies
I
say
am a better example to all of you than the prophet Muhammad. Put your hand up if you agree.
Well, you know what? He's not letting me
put your hand up. Do you agree?
What do you agree
right,
with?
Do you disagree?
Sorry, what do you agree with, my friend?
So let me ask the question again.
I agree that the perfect example today...
Here's your two examples on the question about whether you can
sorry,
have
right.
sex
you're
with
not,
nine-year-olds.
Talk, sorry,
example number
with,
one, Bob the Builder. Example number two, 7th century false prophet called Muhammad. Who is the better example?
What about your granddad,
I
Jimmy Savile?
I say you should not
your
have
granddad,
sex
Jimmy
with
Savile?
Nine-year-olds. Muhammad had sex with a nine-year-old. Put your hand up if you want to follow my example. Now put your hand up if you want to follow Muhammad's example.
Listen, it was
no
1400
one.
Years
not
ago.
Even the Muslim
fasting growing religion.
Not even the Muslim puts his hand up.
It's the fastest
why?
Growing religion, you dumb
why?
Bastard.
Because in his heart... He knows that Muhammad is not an example to follow.
Of course he is. It's the
but because of his
religion,
sense of honor,
growing
because
religion,
of a sense of honor, he can't
religion.
Deny it.
Well, listen,
his heart tells him, I don't want to marry
yes no?
6-year-old children.
Yes no?
I don't want to have sex with 9-year-old children.
Is it or not? Yeah.
But his sense of honor says that he can't denounce
not,
his own prophet.
But you know what I mean?
Yeah?
I don't.
Now, do you want to have a conversation
listen,
that's
you're
time?
Not going to let me talk. So
do you want
point?
To have a conversation
you're not
that's time?
Talk,
we can
no
time
point.
It. This brother can time us. You can have 3 minutes, I can have 3 minutes. Do you want to do that?
Yeah, go on.
Right.
So what do you believe?
Okay, who's starting?
We'll let the brothers speak first.
No, no,
first 3 minutes.
Go,
okay, first three minutes to me. Tell me when you're ready.
We're ready.
Go. Right. So, ladies and gentlemen, we Christians denounce the Prophet Muhammad as a false prophet. We say that Muslims who follow Muhammad are following a lie. And we say this because our Lord gives a test. He says, you shall know them by their fruits, and by their fruits you shall know them. Now, there's been paedophilic practice down through human history. Henry VIII, Jimmy Savile, all paedophiles, all those paedophiles in the Catholic Church, paedophiles. However, ladies and gentlemen, Christians do not hold up Henry VIII as a moral example, Jimmy Savile as a moral example, or all of those paedophile priests as moral examples. By contrast, Muhammad is supposed to be the example for today, which means that what Muhammad did, you should be able to do. So Muslims, all of you here, put your hand up if you're willing to marry a six-year-old child. None of them. Put your hand up if you're willing to have sex with a nine-year-old child. Put your hand up. None of them. Why? Because in their heart, they know better than their false prophets. And it is only because there's a sense of honor that they are not willing to follow through on the conviction of their conscience. The conviction of their conscience says, I can't follow Muhammad. But their sense of honor says that I can't denounce Muhammad. So what do? They obfuscate. I can't even pronounce the word. They blur the lines, blur the issues, throwing up mud, trying to distort from the fact that we Christians look to Jesus as our moral example, not to Henry VIII, not to Jimmy Savile, and not to Catholic priests who were meant to be celibate, not having sex with anyone, let alone children. How long have I got?
1 minute left.
So, ladies and gentlemen,
Jesus' real name?
I am saying to you that on the question of having sex with children, I am better than Muhammad. Because Muhammad had sex with a nine-year-old child and he married a six-year-old.
And he'll be judged.
What kind of six-year-old can turn round to their family and community and say, no, mummy, mummy, I don't want to marry the old man. No six-year-old has that mental capacity. It was child abuse from the beginning to the end. And that means Muhammad is not the best example. And because none of you Muslims were willing to do what your prophet did, proves that you agree with me that Muhammad is not the best example. Now we're having a conversation. Ready?
Basically, yeah, first of all I just want to say is, yeah, Michael H. Hart, whoever knows whoever he is, yeah, he wrote a book on 100 most influential men throughout history. So he named Muhammad as number one. Jesus comes second or third. Look it up. Secondly, I want to say is 100 years ago, 200 years ago, what was the law of England to marry? When you find that out, then think about it, yeah? Now, let's go back to 1400 years ago, yeah? Muhammad had enemies, yes or no? Put your hands up. Did he have enemies? Did Muhammad have enemies 1400 years ago? Yes? Not one enemy said or called him a pedophile. Not one. And it was his friend's daughter, yeah? That was one of the virgins he married. He had more than one wife. All the other ones were divorced or widowed. So right now, yes, we won't marry a nine-year-old right now because times have changed. If you told somebody 1400 years ago about a car today, they will never believe you. But times have changed, but that's why nobody does it now, because times have changed. A nine-year-old girl 1400 years ago in Saudi Arabia don't have the mentality of a nine-year-old girl right now in these times. These times, girls are just small and young, and they don't know about environment or life skills or anything like that. They all got tablets and phones. That's why. Yeah, but they weren't as clever as before 1400 years ago. Think about it. So about 100 years ago, 200 years ago, in this very country, find out what was the legal age to marry a girl. That's what I'm going to say.
So he's not the perfect example.
Wait, bro.
You're taking the time.
But listen, why isn't he the perfect
talk.
Example?
Let him talk.
I want you to say to me, why isn't he the perfect example? Michael H. Hart.
He was going
to
stop. You've just set him off again.
Yeah, yeah. But listen, who is Michael H. Hart? He wrote a book of 100 most influential men.
So they Christian? He's wearing a Holy Warrior t-shirt. You proud of the slaughter of the Muslim populations of the Middle East that was caused by the Crusades?
Don't respond.
Are you proud of the fact that
just
when the
Crusaders were that's the main thing I want to say, that he is the best role model from them days till now. Michael H. Hart, he wrote a book
100 most influential men throughout history, and he named Muhammad number one, okay. Jesus come number three.
What about Bani Qurayza? Tell me about that. Bani Qurayza.
How many Jews did he kill in one day? 900?
30 seconds left.
That's what I want to say to this guy. So he had enemies, and they never called him a pedophile. So why would they called him a magician, but they never called him a pedophile. So that's why I say he is the best example.
That's it. Are you done? Yeah, yeah. Am I allowed to take my 3 minutes?
Well, that's it. You ready? Okay. Three. Listen, I've said what I've got to say. Okay. You've said what you've got to say.
I'm going to take a 3 minutes and reply to what this brother said.
I'm off
okay,
now,
fair enough. Okay, so I just want to reply to what this brother said.
Are you proud of the Christians?
He said.
Are you proud
Muhammad
of the
is mentioned by this scholar as one of the most influential. Yes. One of the most influential people of human history. Well, so what? Lots of other people have pointed Jesus as the most influential person in human history.
Jesus
never had a PhD, but they called him teacher. He never had a slave, but they called him master. He never commanded an army, but they called him a king. He never had medicine, but they called him a healer. More governments have been established in his name. More civilizations have been cultivated because of his teachings. More influence has been done by his teachings and example than by any army that marched or any fleet that ever sailed. Jesus Christ is the one that everybody wants to claim. The Mormons want him. The Jehovah's Witnesses want him. The Hindus want him. The Muslims want him. The Jews want him. But we Christians don't want Muhammad. The Mormons don't want Muhammad. The Jehovah's Witnesses don't want Muhammad. The Sikhs don't want Muhammad. The Hindus don't want Muhammad. Christ is the one who, when you look at him, measure for measure, is greater than Muhammad. Muhammad owned slaves, sold slaves, traded in slaves. Jesus Christ lived in a time when slavery was normal and he never had a single slave, ever. No, they said, why didn't the people in the 7th century call Muhammad a pedophile? Well, they did call him a warmonger back then. Byzantine emperors declaimed Muhammad as a warmonger. So therefore, it is legitimate by this logic to point out that Muhammad was a warmonger that declared war on the pagans in Mecca, stole their property, waged war against them, conquered their lands, and then desecrated their religious artifacts. But Jesus Christ is one who taught us to love as the primary way to live. No, ladies and gentlemen, the superiority of Christian teaching over Islamic teaching is in this. We Christians can absorb new knowledge to influence the understanding of the practice of our faith. So one example, we Christians in the past, our countries used to have ages of consent far lower than today. 12 years old in the 5th century, which incidentally was 2 centuries before Muhammad and still higher than the age of consent as practiced by Muhammad. So even Christians from the 5th century knew better than Muhammad in the 7th century. But we Christians are willing to accept knowledge in the application of our faith. And our knowledge about child development means that we must condemn anyone who thinks that having sex with a 9-year-old child or marrying a 6-year-old is the best example. Put your hands up, Muslims, if you think Muhammad is the best example. You see, they don't. I'll give them another chance. I'll give you another chance. Muslims, don't be ashamed of your paedophile prophet. He is the best example.
Was he the best example on the age of consent?
What's
the age of consent
in Christianity?
Notice, no answer. No answer. And why? Why? Because in their heart they know it's wrong, but because of a sense of honour they can't condemn their prophet, and so they try to change the subject. Let's give them another chance. Let's ask this guy.
Why get rid of Muhammad?
Muhammad had sex with a 9-year-old child. He did have sex with a 9-year-old child. I'm going to say it again. Muhammad had sex with a 9-year-old child. Is that the best example we should follow? Answer the question.
Listen.
Your prophet had sex with a 9-year-old child. Is it the best example? Answer the question. Notice, you don't want to answer the question.
What do you mean?
Ask this question.
I'll ask the question.
Doesn't want to answer the question. Right, let's ask the question again. Muhammad had sex with a 9-year-old child. Should I follow that example?
You're a son of a bitch.
Should I?
Listen.
Should I follow that example?
You're getting triggered already.
Can I speak?
Yeah, answer the question.
Can I speak? Don't say that. I can't speak.
Answer the question.
I'll answer. How old was he until he got married to her?
Okay.
How old was he when he got married
to her? Doesn't want to answer
the question. I'm answering. How old was he?
Why don't they want to answer the question?
How old was he?
Because they know in their heart they don't want to follow Muhammad's example. This brother doesn't want to have sex with his children. This brother does not want to have sex with children. This brother does not want to have sex with children. And that is why they can't say Muhammad is an example to follow.
How old was he when he married?
Answer the question.
How old was he when he married her?
50-odd years old.
How old? That's so wrong.
54.
How old was he?
He was not even 54.
How old was he? How old was he when he had sex with a 9-year-old? How old was he?
Your breath stinks. Let me fucking speak.
How old was he?
Let me fucking speak. That's it.
Do you see how triggered they become?
All of you hear what?
Triggered.
Back in the day. Nabi Muhammad used to have a chance to chat to him.
So, ladies and gentlemen, if the Muslims can't follow Muhammad, let them follow Jesus. Because Christians, now I want to ask the Christians a question. Will, do you want to put your hand up if you're a Christian? Answer this question loud and clear. Do you want to follow Jesus in everything he did? Do you want to follow Jesus in everything that he did? We can say of Jesus what the Mohammedans cannot say of Muhammad. And that is why Jesus is a better example than Muhammad. That is why Jesus is better than Muhammad.
You're abstaining from women. That's why he never got married. You're a holy son. You don't know your Quran, bro.
Put your hands up if you're a follower of the pedophile priesthood.
This brother is nearly as old as Muhammad. So imagine a man who looks like this mounting a 9-year-old girl and ask yourself if that is the example you want to follow. Because that's Muhammad. Pedophile prophet Muhammad.
Why did Jesus have no female apostles?
Ask the Muslims.
Because Jesus liked the
Ask what the Quran says.
Brothers,
he will abstain from women.
Hello, brothers. Don't get triggered. That's what he wants.
He wants you to get triggered already.
He is triggered
20 minutes ago.
Totally triggered.
As soon as they got here, they were triggered. Because I can't defend my prophet.
That's why you can't follow him.
Can't follow him.
That's why you can't follow him.
You can't mean? Follow your prophet.
Follow you don't want to follow him. You do follow him. You can't
so
follow
him. So you don't want to marry him.
There
you go. Thank you. Thank you.
You're a proud Christian pedophile.
So.
Put your hands up. Oh, now you're not Christian.
Exactly.
Now you're not Christian.
Exactly.
Oh, God, man. Put your hands up if you're a proud Christian pedophile.
They're not going to put their hands up.
Put your hands up, bro. I thought he was just going to stop at proud Christian.
Of course not. He's a Muslim.
Right. No! Let me just reply to the rhetoric. So the brother shouts and he talks about paedophile Christians. By his logic, he condemns Muhammad. He condemns his own prophet. Because if he admits that paedophilia is wrong, then that means that when Muhammad had sex with a 9-year-old child, Muhammad was wrong. So when he attacks Catholic priests who brutalize and vandalize the innocence of children because of their paedophilia, then that means it's wrong when Muhammad did it as well. So thank you very much. You condemn your own prophet by attacking the paedophiles in the Catholic Church. But here's the difference. Every Christian, including Roman Catholics, will join you in attacking Catholic priests who are paedophiles. But the Muslims will condemn a paedophile priest.
You are paedophile.
But not you are a paedophile prophet.
He is a paedophile. He is one.
And that shows that their conscience condemns Muhammad. And it is only cognitive dissonance. That you means that their logic will not condemn Muhammad as well.
Talk to me then. So what are you talking about?
What did he say?
What?
He married her when she was six.
No, he
then
didn't.
Then he had consummated marriage when she was
no,
nine.
No, he didn't.
So what does that say?
No, he didn't.
What's your sources?
Where's your sources?
Okay, I'll bring my sources.
Show me your sources.
The Bible doesn't say.
It's silent. Which means, because the Bible is silent about it, it's down for us to make an intellectual choice.
Well, so that intellectual choice can be different from
a subjective.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Right, no, but this is, now you've helped me to condemn your prophet.
So,
1 second, you've just helped me to condemn your prophet even more.
No. First, I never accepted this account.
1 second, bro, you know how this goes, right? If you say something and then I try to reply to something that you say, and then you talk over me, I just shout, and I get out what I'm saying.
No problem.
So if you want to have a conversation, let's have a conversation.
So first,
we can even time it if you want.
No problem, let's time it.
Right, we need a timer.
We need a timer.
Can someone bring a timer?
Yeah, I'll time it on my phone, no problem.
Right, we'll do 3 minutes.
Sure.
Right, so I'm going to do 3 minutes.
Okay, starting, go.
So, one second, because you asked me the question. So in terms of...
So what was my question?
Stop my time. Okay,
start again.
Stop interrupting.
No problem.
Okay, ready?
Go.
Stop.
Right, so this brother said, he asked me, what does the Bible say is the age of consent? And I said, the Bible is silent about this question. And then he said, oh, well, it's open to confusion then. And I said, no. What the silence of the Bible means is it is now down to our intellectual choice and faculty to decide what the age of consent is. And different societies and communities have given different ages of consent. Consistently higher than the paedophile Muhammad when he had sex with a 9-year-old child. The Byzantine Christians in the 5th century raised the age of consent to 12. It's still way too young. The fact of the matter is, as our knowledge of child development grows, societies around the world have consistently, every society, raised the age of consent. Why? Because we recognize that a 6-year-old doesn't have the mental and emotional faculties to agree to a marriage. But Muhammad, a so-called prophet, thought that a 6-year-old could make a conscious choice about marriage. Furthermore, Muhammad, the so-called best example in the world, had sex with a 9-year-old child. And I've asked Muslims multiple times, would you be open to having sex with a 9-year-old child? And to their credit, everyone, to a man in this park, is better
than Muhammad. And if you are better than your paedophile prophet, then you are better than Muhammad as an example on this question. And we Christians are better than your false prophet, paedophile Muhammad. Because your paedophile child
get this on camera. He likes touching boys.
It's not someone you want to follow. And it's not someone we want to
follow.
But we Christians, so we're going to interrupt him and he'll come back. We Christians say that in our faith, because this question is not decided by an example in the Bible, it is a question open to our reasonable faculties. And our reasonable faculties in every civilization and society has raised the age of consent above 9. So let me end my diatribe, my monologue, with a question for the Mohammedan. Let me ask him, according to Islamic tradition,
according to the Sunnah, according to the so-called greatest example that we all should follow, what is the age of consent in Islam?
Okay, how long did he have?
3 minutes.
3 minutes. I don't need 3 minutes. I'll respond back to you in 1 minute. So firstly, you...
Wait.
All right, stop.
So he had 3 minutes. All I need is 1 minute, inshallah, okay? So firstly, you made a claim that the Holy Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, married Aisha at the age of 6. Firstly, this narrative is taken from Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. There's a problem with this tradition itself. If you go to the chain of transmission, Hisham ibn Urwa was the person who narrated from Aisha, and they say when he moved to Iraq, they won his life, he became old and he became weak in memory. All the traditions that come about Aisha's age is from Aisha herself. Okay, so firstly, if you're going to bring me narrative, I don't accept Sahih Bukhari anyway. I don't accept Sahih Muslim. This is not my hadith collection to accept, because you're speaking to a Shia here, not a Sunni. Now, firstly, number one, from a Sunni perspective, not all Sunnis accept this. There's a difference of opinion, number one. Number two, you couldn't even prove what the specified age of a relationship with a woman according to the Bible. It's not clear. Number three, we know according to the customs of the people of the time, going back over maybe 1500, 1500 years ago, it wasn't uncommon for people to marry at a young age. In fact, let's specify the age of consummation of relationship now. Go to one state, it'll be one age. Go to another state, it'll be another age. Go to France, England. That means that according to the French law, the British people would be considered to be paedophiles because the age of consent of relationship is different. So you cannot specify a clear-cut age of a relationship, number one. Number two, there's no authentic tradition that proves Aisha was 6 at the time and the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, consummated the marriage at the age of 9. Number two. Number three, according to the customs of the Jews, if you refer to the Old Testament, you'll notice that there are passages which talks about having sexual relations with even minors. Am I wrong about saying this? Maybe you can clarify that to me afterwards. That's point number three.
Have you heard an answer to my question yet?
What was Aisha?
He's not answered my question yet, has he? Maybe he'll do it towards the end. Did I not say he'd complain? Remember when he was talking to him?
I will give you 10 seconds.
1 minute.
I'll give you 10 seconds from my time to ask me that question. Gone. You got 10 seconds from my time.
Your time.
I will give you 10 seconds from my time to give me number one an authentic tradition that's not been narrated from Aisha. Number two, that's not come through Hisham ibn Urwa. Number three, specify me a clear age from the Bible which you could not. Number four, the age differences from one civilization to another is subjective. Yeah, you said that, you know, it depends on the time period, etc. So why are you applying rules which were 1,400 years ago now? Gone.
Are you done?
Yeah, I'm done. Gone.
Okay, stop.
All right.
Right. So he stopped early. Reset. 3 minutes. Right. So he has spoke for 2:30, and he didn't answer the question. Didn't answer the question. Let me just. Always look. He's interrupting. Let me just remind everybody how I ended my last talk. I asked a question. According to Muhammad, according to the best example, what is the age of consent in Islam? Now, to defend Islam, to defend his paedophile prophet, what did the brother do? He chucked Sahih al-Bukhari under the bus. Now, he did it because he's a Shia, which means that he chucked the vast majority of Muslims under the bus at the same time, because the vast majority of Muslims accept the teaching of Sahih al-Bukhari. So he's saying that because this embarrasses me, I don't accept it. But let's deal with him as a Shia, not as a Sunni, because that's fair. Because it's true that Muslims have no agreement about which hadiths are trustworthy. They can't agree. And so their interpretations of Islam differ vastly based upon which hadiths they believe in. And yet Muslims to a man attack Christianity because of differences connected to the Old Testament, completely ignorant of the fact that Christians have 100% agreement about the books of the New Testament. Now, I will ask the question again. Muhammad, the best example, what age of consent did he give? What number are you willing to peg yourself to, O Muslims? Those Muslims who do agree with Sahih al-Bukhari are pinned to an age that a six-year-old has the mental and emotional faculties to marry, and then he's physically ready as soon as she can bleed. If you can bleed, you can breed, is the motto of the Sunni Salafist. That is the motto of the Sunni Salafist. We Christians, we have a better religion than Islam. Our religion does not put this question down to a prophet's example stuck in cultures in the past that were so hard-hearted that they couldn't understand ideas about childhood development. We, as Christians, allow certain questions to be answered by the reasonable faculty of our mind. It says in Scripture, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Okay, so Jesus. 3 minutes. Give him. Yeah, sort of. Yeah, ready when you are. Go, sir.
Okay.
Your time.
So, if you notice, Bob totally ignored my point about the narration from Bukhari and Muslim. Forget I'm a Shia. Let's look at it from a Sunni point of view. Now, there's a narration mentioned in Tafqat ibn Sa'd, which says that the Holy Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, the difference of age between Aisha and, I believe, her sister Asma was 6 months. And when Asma passed away, I believe Aisha was maybe 18 at the time. But if you actually calculate the dates, you'll notice that Aisha was actually much older than the original claim made. Number one, can you give me a tradition that's not been narrated via Aisha from Hisham ibn Urwa, because this particular narrator was accused of having weak memory when he moved to Iraq, they say. So number one, there's a problem with the actual tradition itself. Number two, there's no specified age according to the Bible. And as you said, it's subjective. Because if a group of people here decide that, you know, six, for example, is the correct age, it would become six. So there's nothing in the Bible which forbids marrying a minor. Number three, how can you complain about the age and consent of marriage when your own societies abort unborn children? You kill unborn children. If you've got a problem with paedophilia, you should also have a problem with aborting your unborn children, because in your society, Christian society, you people support the
he still hasn't actually answered my question. I asked him a question. You weren't saying that when he was shouting. When the other guy was shouting, you weren't saying that. It's all right, bro. But I mean, the thing is.
Okay. Look, carry on.
Yeah. So basically, I asked him, what was the age of consent in Islam? No one's stopping you from talking. Let him talk. Keep going. No. Don't let him talk. Because he was talking to him when I was talking, remember? So the thing is, they always want to live by a double standard. So what I'm saying is, I asked this guy a question. This is his time. No one's stopping him. I'm talking to you. He's losing his own time. So I asked him a question about what was the...
1 minute.
You've got 1 minute. What was the time? What was the age of consent? What was the age of consent in Islam? Because we as Christians say that this is down to reasonable faculty. We humans decide it. But in Islam, they say Muhammad tells us everything. But Muhammad had sex with a 9-year-old. And they're embarrassed by that.
It was a cultural practice, even going back 1,400 years ago, for people to get married at a very young age. Number five.
Age of 9 to 10, people were getting married even in Great Britain.
Okay, let me ask you a question. How old was Mary?
30 seconds.
How old was Mary when she married Jesus' father, Joseph? Please tell us. You can end my time. Go on, end it.
Okay.
He's not going to be able to answer my points anyway.
Are you done, or you want to carry on?
Okay,
3 minutes. Ready.
Begin.
So, for the second time in a row, I asked one question. Can he tell me What age does Islam prescribe as the age of consent? And for the second time, after over 5 minutes of speaking, we still don't have an age. But what he did do in those 2.5 minutes is he did throw Imam Bukhari under the bus. He said that Imam Bukhari, in his later years, had weak faculty of mind. That's what he said. He also threw Aisha under the bus, because Aisha is the source in Imam Bukhari for her own age. And notice, the Muslim isn't protesting that he should shut up now like he was protesting earlier. Double standards of Islam, because their prophet was a supremacist and Muslims feel superior. So they feel that they can do to you what they don't like you to do to them. Which is why, if we advocate that every Muslim should be made a dhimmi and live like dhimmis, they would all be crying out, Islamophobia, Islamophobia. But they're quite happy to make Christians dhimmis in Muslim majority countries. So, furthermore, I am still waiting for the answer to the question. What age do you want to peg yourself to, and what basis do you legitimize the age? Then he argued from other hadiths, demonstrating that with a bit of fluky-booky, Sufism, a bit of reasoning, you can come up with a different age for Aisha. So what does that prove? It proves that your hadiths contradict themselves. So if the hadiths contradict themselves by your own reasoning, then that means that they can't be trusted. Because you attack the Bible because you say the Bible contradicts itself. So if you attack the Bible because it contradicts itself, you shouldn't trust your hadiths because they contradict themselves. Practice what you preach. We Christians are not ashamed of the idea that certain questions are open to the human faculty of reason. Notice, not protesting, not protesting. Why? Why? Because our faith says that you can work out your salvation with fear and trembling. You're supposed to reason as a Christian from your salvation to do good. And it is not good to have sex with kids.
Okay. 3 minutes.
Okay, yeah.
Hold on. Oh, wait, well, you want them to serve now?
Hold on. No, wait.
I told him to.
Oh, everybody spread out.
Spread out. Asif, you're sunk, mate.
No, I'm never.
Spread out.
You're talking rubbish.
Me and me. Guys, spread out. Please. Spread out. The police are trying to keep Speaker's Corner open. They can only do that if we cooperate. So please, spread out. Go on.
So, wait. So I just want to make a quick couple of points before I go, because it seems Bob is trying to force a narrative upon me which I don't accept. So number one, I didn't throw Aisha under the bus. No, I didn't. Number two, what I said is the person who narrated it from Aisha, Hisham ibn Urwa, he had weak memory later on in his life. So scholars have criticized any traditions of his which come from him later. Number two. Number three, according to the reports about Aisha's age, there's a difference of opinion. As I mentioned, there's a tradition mentioned in the Qatib ibn Sa'd, which shows that when Asma, her sister, passed away, there was only a slight age of difference. And at the time, I believe Asma may have been around between, she's around 24, roughly about this age, but Aisha was much older than previously claimed. Number four, you cannot specify a clear age for marriage according to the Bible. Number six, you asked me a question. You said, at what age can a man marry a woman or have a relationship with a woman? This is a subjective issue, because the intellect of one girl can differ to another, okay? Number one. Number two, it can also differ according to the culture and the time period. Bro,
you're being rude to everyone. I'm trying to listen to him. I can't hear him over you guys.
Hold on.
I can only destroy Muslim arguments if I can hear them.
Stop interrupting, boys.
I believe point number five, I said, look, at the end of the day, Islam makes it very explicit that
Yes, test them with their intellect, okay?
Yes,
so this
intellect.
Is something which is subjective, okay? Because for one person, from one girl to another girl, it could be different. Going to one culture community, it could be different. Now, what we do know for certain is, forget Islam for a minute, let's go according to the Jewish customs. At what age were the Jews at that particular period of time marrying? What age? At what age were they marrying? Now from this, it will give us a rough idea that even if we were to accept that such a marriage did take place, it was not something which was from the unordinary. In fact, name me one single non-Muslim person who criticized the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, for even marrying Aisha at that time. The Prophet had many enemies of Islam. Yet there were many enemies of Islam. Why didn't a single person criticize that marriage? This would have been the first thing they would have attacked him on. Now, again, Bob, the issue with you is you cannot define paedophilia. Because paedophilia is something which is a subjective matter, and it differs from one country to another. The French may consider the British people to be paedophiles. Why? Because the age of consent of marriage is different from France. Go to America, it's different from one state to another. So I will conclude on a final point, Bob, and that is you cannot specify a age on the consent of marriage. And number two, you need to stop bringing cultural norms or what could have been considered normal at that particular moment in time with modern what's happening now in the 20th century.
Okay, so I reply. So, right, notice, ladies and gentlemen, for the third time in a row, I asked him, what is the age of consent in Islam? And he didn't give me an age. Not one. But his essential criticism of Christianity is apparently Christianity doesn't give an age of consent. So if Christianity is to be dismissed because it doesn't give an age of consent, what am I supposed to conclude by the fact that after three goes, the Muslim can't give me an age of consent from within Islam? And why is that? Because if Muslims reject the age given by Imam Bukhari, by Aisha, that Muhammad had sex with a 9-year-old girl and married someone who was six, if they reject that, then they don't have an age to go by. They only have conjecture. And that means that Islam is no different to Christianity in this regard, except for one thing that has gone straight sailing over the head of every Muslim who makes this argument. And it's this: we Christians do not have an understanding of Jesus Christ that Muslims have of Muhammad. You think that Muhammad is the best example in everything that he does. We Christians believe that Christ is the best example by the ethic that he lived by. And that ethic that he lived by means that we should seek the good of others, including children, whom Christ our Lord said, he who causes one of these little ones to stumble, it is better for him that a rock be tied around his neck and he be cast into the sea. Muhammad had sex with a child, Aisha, by Aisha's own testimony and by the testimony of Imam Bukhari. If this Muslim can't give me an Islamic age of consent, then Islam is no different to Christianity, and his criticism of Christianity is invalid. Christianity is not ashamed to say that some things are opening to the reasoning of humanity. The age of consent is one of these things, and history shows the consensus of humanity that 9 is too young. Want to try again? Fourth attempt.
No.
Hold on, okay.
I've responded to
you. Haven't answered my question. What was the age of consent in Islam? What's the age of consent? Sorry, I'm talking to him.
What's the age of consent in Christianity?
Stop interrupting. Everybody, please.
Firstly, number one, I think we need to reduce the time down because what's happening is becoming impossible.
You've got to read that with Bobbin.
Yeah. What do we want? To what? 3 minutes is way too long.
He's running out of puff. Let's do 2 minutes. Do 2 minutes. 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 He's running out of bullets, ladies and gentlemen.
He doesn't need a lot of bullets.
Hold on, hold on.
The powder keg's running dry.
Carry on, man. Carry on. God bless you, Bob.
Okay, so firstly, if you notice something, Bob totally ignored my point. I said, look, if the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, married Aisha at that particular age, and it was such a major issue, name me one single person from his opponents who raised an objection about this matter. Name me one. You can't, you ignore that. Number two, you said specify an age of marriage according to Islam. I already explained to you, it differs from one person to the other. It's subjective. As you mentioned, you can't apply what happened 400 years ago with what's going on now, okay? It's something which is subjective. Number three, I mentioned the issue about the tradition about Aisha's age anyway, which you disregarded. Number four, what was a common practice of the time? Number five, as you said, the Bible's not clear about it. Number six, it differs from one country to another. And again, over time, this is something which we know till today. There's some states, there's some places in America where you can be a 10-year-old and marry. So there's nothing unusual about it. That's fine, 1 minute. 1 minute.
Are you stopped?
Yeah, 1 minute. Okay. Yeah. 1 minute.
We'll do I'll take my full 2 minutes.
Okay.
You want 2 minutes?
Go, Bob.
So for what? Was this the fourth or the fifth time now? I can't even remember. He hasn't... What he said was this. What he said was this. Fourth Bob. Right, he hasn't given age of consent. What he has admitted is this. That it's subjective. Which, that's what he said. In Islam, it's subjective. But in the next breath, he's criticizing Christianity because Christianity doesn't give an age of consent. So when Christianity doesn't give an age of consent, that's a reason to criticize Christianity. But when Islam doesn't give an age of consent, suddenly this is the perfect guidance of Allah. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the fact, notice he's interrupting. Ladies and gentlemen, the fact is the brother has just reduced Islam to the level of Christianity. It is subjective in Christianity, and according to this brother, because he rejects Sahih al-Bukhari, because he rejects Imam Bukhari, because he rejects Aisha, because he rejects the vast majority of Sunni Muslims, because he rejects those people, it's now subjective in Shia Islam. Well, I applaud him for being better than the Sunnis. I applaud him for being better for the Shia, for being better than those Sunnis who want to uphold a paedophile as a prophet. At least he gets around that problem. But he creates another problem, which is that it means that Muslims are making up Islam on the spot. Sharia law about the age of consent is subjective. It's bid'ah. So they're no better than us Christians. But the difference is we Christians are permitted in our religion to reason from our revelation. We're allowed to use our human mind to come to human decisions about human things. In Islam, they claim otherwise.
Now, firstly, number one, I have utmost respect for the different denominations of Islam. Let's make it clear. In fact, I have utmost respect for, irrespective of what faith you follow. What's important is manners, okay? Discussing, when you discuss with people, there needs to be certain ethics in place and manners. And you, as a Christian, you should know this as well in the way Jesus, how he conducted himself, okay? So you keep saying to me that, look, it's, I said to you before, it's subjective. And the Bible's not clear about it. In fact,
You stand. You got to project your voice. That's what's drawing people in.
Keep going.
Yeah, unfortunately, Bob, I'm not as good as you when it comes to raising my voice, and this is not something which I do regularly. So, number one, as I mentioned before, it's something which is subjective.
Become Christian.
It's Muslim, man.
Bro, please let me just speak to him. I just want to make my. What I do is I make my.
Start again.
No.
So I'm going to make my, well, I was going to finish off about a couple of minutes ago, but Bob keeps asking the same thing. At what age can you have a relationship with a girl? As I mentioned before, it's something which is subjective. The Bible's not clear about it, neither is Islam to a certain degree. Islam, however, does say one thing. It says, and test them. This is what the verse of the Holy Quran says, is test them with their intellect, okay? So, you know, you can sit and say, taking the moral high ground as a Christian, when you don't offer no solution in society. In fact, in your society, it's quite common for girls as young as 13 to get pregnant. They have no rights. Yeah. They get dumped.
Yeah, they end up having abortions, etc. You got a major issue in your community of single mothers. But Islam obviously offers a solution for society, the general society. But coming back to the point, number one, I never threw Aisha under the bus. Number two, as I mentioned before, there's problems with those traditions and the conflicting reports. All the reports come through a person called Hisham bin Urwa. Number three, cultural practices of the time. Not a single person from the enemies of the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, criticized him for this marriage.
Time.
And Bob, again,
time.
Cannot provide me a single person.
Time. Okay. So what we got basically, ladies and gentlemen, that finally the Muslim admits that Islam is no better than Christianity. It's subjective in Islam, it's subjective in Christianity. So what kind of criticism is it to say to Christians, well, the Bible doesn't give an age of consent? Well, it clearly doesn't in Islam, according to his version of Islam, because after four attempts of trying to get the answer, he came down to, oh, it's subjective. It's subjective to who? To your intellect. So that means that the so-called great guidance of Islam boils down to is, what's your opinion? That's what it is. But we Christians are permitted to do this in our religion. In Islam, it says that on this day, I have perfected your religion for you and completed my blessings upon you. Well, if he perfected and completed the haram and the halal, as I'm told, then what is it? Halal or haram to have sex with 9-year-old children? So if it is down to a subjective opinion, then that means you receive no guidance. And if you've received no guidance, your revelation is neither perfected nor is it completed, which means your Quran is lying to you when it says that it is.
Perfect.
But we Christians have said that we follow Jesus Christ. We are allowed to reason about these human questions. Unanimously, the age of consent has gone up. Even before Muhammad, it went up to 12. Muhammad brought it down according to the Sunnis, and the Shias know better than the Sunnis, so they reject the sources of the Sunnis because their hadiths contradict one another. Never managed to get on to Christian society diatribe, but we'll come back to that.
Yeah, so Bob,
hold on. Go on.
So you mentioned that. Okay, so what you can do, so there's a particular word you might be familiar to. It's something, it's called ijtihad. Ijtihad is when a scholar deduces ruling from Quran and Hadith. So they would look at certain matters and decide whether the certain norms of that particular society, whether certain acts would be considered permissible or impermissible. So there are secondary laws which also make certain acts unlawful. Now you said, as you admitted, that the Bible doesn't specify a particular age for marriage, okay? Islam does, however, say that test them with their intellect. Now, whether the Bible says that or not, I don't know. You can tell me whether the Bible says test them with their age. But you also mentioned something important. You said as time changes, people's views and thoughts change. What's accepted then may not necessarily be accepted now. I already said to you that, look, not a single opponent from the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, raised an objection with this particular marriage. If it was something which was not commonly accepted or against the culture of a particular time, they would have raised an objection to it. Yes, okay, in this day and age, let's assume that this marriage did take place. Would somebody in this particular age marry somebody as young as that age? Maybe not. They wouldn't. I mean, I don't know many Muslims who marry 5 or 6 year olds, and if they have done, then definitely, according to the cultural norm of what we're living in now, it's something which most definitely wouldn't be acceptable to a certain degree. Why? For secondary reasons. Not because there's clear-cut textual evidence against it, but maybe perhaps for secondary reasons. And this is what, that's the point I wanted to make.
Okay.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, Bob. I'm going to check my 2 minutes.
Okay. Go on. Go, Bob.
So, he's talked about ijtihad, and he's right, I do know what ijtihad means. Because, unlike most of the Muslims here in the park who are attacking Christianity, I actually have a degree in religious studies. I actually specialize in Islam and Christianity. So yes, I know what ijtihad means. Ijtihad is proof, ladies and gentlemen, that when the Quran said that I have perfected your religion this day and completed my blessings upon you about what is haram and halal, that it was wrong. Because Muslims ever since that day have been completing the completed and perfecting the perfected, which demonstrates the illogical inconsistency of the claims of the Quran. We Christians in the Bible are called to use our reason our intellect and to be wise and prudent. And that is why in the 5th century we raised the age of consent. 2 centuries before Muhammad married a 6-year-old and had sex with a 9-year-old. We raised it to 12, still too low, but we know better, and Christians argue for higher ages of consent. The brother pointed out the problems in Western society. Single mothers, pregnant teenagers, all of it is true. We've got that kind of rot in the West. Why? Because the Westerners abandoned the Christian faith and now they are reaping the harvest of what they have sown into the world. But is Islam better? Honor killings, bombs, murders of apostates, raping. These things still occur in Islamic cultures. Egypt, Pakistan, go and check it out if you don't believe me. It's not like Islam made the Muslim world better, it just made it different.
So Bob, out of all people, you should know that Shias are also victim to terrorism as well, okay? So
I wasn't talking about terrorism.
You're talking about people
talking about bombs. Talking yeah. about talking about everyday experiences of Christians in Pakistan and Egypt.
Yeah, yeah, and as I said to you before,
kidnapping of Christian girls in Egypt.
We oppose this as well. As Shias, we are also victim of this issue as well. In fact, Sunnis are also victim of this extremism mentality, which
Sunni girls don't get kidnapped.
They do. But okay, let's figure that out for a second. Wow, 30 seconds already gone.
We'll give you 30 more.
No problem. So coming back to the point, Bob, there's a few issues here. Number one, as I stated to you before, you admit yourself that the consent of age of marriage... Ijtihad, you mentioned Ijtihad. Ijtihad doesn't mean Islam is complete. Ijtihad is a method that scholars deduce ruling from Quran and Hadith. For example, electrical toothbrush. Is this something halal or haram? There were no electrical toothbrushes around that time. Yes, scholars will look at something similar. So you have something called a miswak, which is a stick which they use to brush the teeth. So halal and haram has got nothing to do with the fact that Islam is incomplete. In fact, there's many issues which we face today in a society. One of the discussions which we're talking about now, which is the age of consent of marriage, the Bible doesn't even have a clear-cut solution to this. So how can you sit there taking the moral high ground, trying to say, oh, well, the Quran is not clear about this issue. The Quran Hadith is not clear about this issue. So, that's it. So the point is, ijtihad, number one, you misrepresented what ijtihad is. Ijtihad is deducing ruling from Quran Hadith, where a scholar would look for an incident in the past and apply certain rules now. So as you mentioned, the age of consent of marriage increased over time. No problem. Today, many scholars would say for cultural reasons, such a marriage would not even be suitable to begin with in the first place. So again, Bob, I ask you, I say this to you about 1,000 times before as well, give me proof that somebody from the opponents of the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, criticized him for this marriage if it occurred. Give me proof.
You got 30 more?
No, that's it.
Okay, stop.
Okay. Go, Bob.
So, ladies and gentlemen, once again, what we see is that attacks made against Christians, when we reverse them, Muslims want to distance themselves from those attacks. The brother has made a point about pointing out teenage pregnancies and extramarital sex in the West, as if that's a criticism of Christianity. That is not a criticism of Christianity. That is a criticism of the absence of Christianity in the West.
Perfect.
Not a criticism of Christianity in the West. Those are not the same criticism. However, can I show you that Muhammad allowed for people to be taken as captives in war and raped? Yes, I can. Surah 4:25. Now, he said the ijtihad is not about improving perfection, improving completedness. But I've gone around this park asking Muslims about Surah 5:3, which says this. This day, so that's a day 1400 years ago, I have perfected your religion for you, completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you the religion of Islam. Yeah. If it was perfected and completed, there's no reason for ijtihad. Ijtihad is an proof that it was neither perfected nor completed, and that the Quran is saying something that's just logically false. By contrast, as Christians, what do we believe? We believe that our Lord said these words: there are many more things that I desire to say to you, but you cannot receive them now. So I will pray to the Father, and he shall send another comforter, another paraclete, who will guide you into all truth. Which means that Christians not only have the scope for our religion to change over time, but also we have the permission, because we're commanded to work out our salvation with fear and trembling, something that the Quran does not do.
So, guys, apologise. I'm a bit short for time as well because I need to join the procession which is taking place on the other side of the road. So, again, Bob, look, halal and haram has already been established. And this is why in our school of thought, we have a principle. Everything is halal till proven haram. Meaning, if there's nothing explicit mentioned in Quran and Hadith, it's permitted for us. Okay? So, it's very clear. Look, as you as a Christian, you would agree, and me as a Muslim, and I don't know if I'm speaking on your behalf or not, but you believe that society should be run, as you admitted, the issue with you know, girls getting pregnant at the age of 13, whatever age this could be, is because they've abandoned the Christian principles and the Christian teachings. And as a Muslim, I would say something similar as well. I believe that society, to a certain degree, needs to follow laws, be it Christian laws to a certain degree or Muslim laws. You cannot escape following laws, be it man-made laws or God laws, okay? So now, So that's the point about ijtihad. Number one, ijtihad doesn't mean that Islam lacks in something. No, everything is halal till proven haram. But where there's certain matters which we're uncertain about, we can refrain from these matters, as the hadith says, or we can try to find certain rules and regulations, certain principles which appeared in the past and we can apply them to today. Like, for example, as I mentioned about a toothbrush, electrical toothbrush, watching TV, keeping pictures, etc., whatever. Number two, in terms of the age of consent or marriage, as I said to you before, Bob, look, the Christianity doesn't give a solution to what age a girl can get married to. And as you said, it can change from one century to another, from one place to another. And as a Muslim, I'm telling you now, it's something similar, okay? At the end of the day, you cannot apply what happened 1,400 years ago to what's happening now at the moment. So it's not a cultural norm for any Muslim man to marry a child of 5 or 6 years of age.
10 seconds.
But yeah, that's it, Bob. I just want to finish on that point.
What's your name?
Ali.
Ali. It was really nice to speak to Ali. There was a lot of shouting.
I'm not used to speaking up.
Sometimes I'm so used to shouting that even when I don't need to, I shout because I'm so used to having to shout. But Ali, it was really lovely to speak to you. I'd like to give you a gift just to show that my
apologies, I have nothing to give in return.
That's no worries. Next time.
I have no hard feelings. Whatever you say.
Yeah, that's fine.
You're entitled to say.
Well, I mean, the thing is, my criticisms of Islam is based upon Sunni Islam, of which Shia Islam escapes. But what I would say to you, sir, is that you can no more attack the Christian faith for not giving an age of consent. You did in this debate, and everyone will see it.
I wasn't trying to attack the Christian faith.
What I was trying to say to you that there's no guidance.
No.
And you were giving that as a flaw.
No, what I was.
But by the end of the debate, you was agreeing that Islam gives no guidance either. It's ijtihad.
No. I wasn't trying to attack Christianity. I was not trying to attack Christianity. What I was trying to say to you is, how can you as a Christian take the moral high ground of the age of what the Prophet married when within Christianity, there's no clear-cut solution into what that age is anyway. That's the point I was trying to make to you. Whether you took that the wrong way, I apologise. That was not my intention to defend you.
So as the debate progressed, what you'll have noticed is my criticism of Shia Islam shifted. My criticism started off aimed at Sunni Islam because of the age of consent thing connected to the Imam Bukhari. And there I can take the moral high ground.
Yeah, I understand.
One second.
You can.
Thank you. Right, brilliant. Yeah, so on the question of the Sunni Muslims who believe in those hadiths, I can take the moral high ground.
100%.
But as our debate progressed, my criticism shifted to adapt to the fact that you're a Shia. And I wasn't criticizing. I wasn't criticizing you for advocating an age of consent. I was criticizing Shia Islam because it doesn't. Because Muhammad is supposed to be the best example.
Right.
But if he isn't an example that tells me about something as fundamental as the age of consent, then he's not the best example. I'm a better example.
Yeah.
You know?
Bob, there's one thing you have to bear in mind.
But hold on one second. Sorry, 1 second. Because your other part of your defense was, who was criticizing Muhammad for... But the point is, that in a way is admitting that he did marry someone who was too young.
Only from that point of view, if we were to look at it from that point of view, that's all I was trying to say. What I'm trying to say to you, if it did occur,
which I think it did,
surely these questions need to be asked. Do you get my point?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If somebody was
your enemy and they saw you walking out with a 5 or 6 year old girl every day,
exactly,
and say that's Bob's wife,
yeah,
do you not think that people would be criticized?
But if I lived in a society when everyone was doing that, no one would batter an eyelid. Exactly. So that proves evidence of the fact that it probably did. Because everyone at that time was doing it. Everyone at that time was doing it, bro. Why would Muhammad be any different? So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to do a wrap-up. We have before us a choice between Christianity and Islam. And when it comes to the age of consent, nothing throws this choice into more sharp relief than the question about the age of consent. Islam makes a claim to be perfect guidance about all the kind of issues that make that humans, that we should live by. But as we've just seen, the Shia are embarrassed by their Sunni brothers in Islam because their Sunni brothers in Islam have to defend an age of consent that is far too low. A six-year-old that supposedly has the emotional, mental faculties to say yes to a marriage, and a nine-year-old who is physically ready to have sex. Now, when it comes to Shia, the Shia get around that problem. They get around that problem by chucking Imam Bukhari under the bus, by chucking most Sunnis under the bus, by chucking Aisha under the bus. And yes, it gets round the problem. Gets round the problem. It gets round the problem. So in terms of, okay, I'm just going to embarrass this guy.